Welcome to The Kill Count, where we tally up the victims in all our favorite horror movies. I'm James A. Janisse, and today we're looking at Freddy vs. Jason, released in 2003. In our modern age of crossovers and shared universes, it's difficult to overstate how cool it is this movie got made. Sure, the Universal monsters had hung out with each other, but that was half a century prior. In 2003, dream matchups between iconic characters were still mostly relegated to comic books. This was a big-budget showdown between the Dream Demon of Springwood and the Hockey Mask Machete Man from Crystal Lake. It was an event so monumental, they held a weighing-in at the Vegas Bally's a month before the premiere.
What's the matter? Can't you speak for yourself, Hockey Puck?
The owners of these two horror titans had been trying to make some form of Freddy vs. Jason since the late 80s. After 15 years, the movie had become the bastard child of 100 rewrites. 18 drafts were done by 12 screenwriters, some featuring a cult of so-called Fredheads, some with even weirder shit. You don't want to know. Mark Swift and Damian Shannon finally came up with a premise that didn't suck. Freddy has lost his powers because the kids of Springwood have forgotten who he is. To make them remember him, he resurrects Jason from hell and sends him on a killing spree. Then, like so many other evil masterminds, he loses control of his subject and the two go head to head. Freddy vs. Jason found a champion at New Line in Stokely Chaffin, a longtime horror fan who produced I Know What You Did Last Summer and I Still Know What You Did Last Summer. But she did not produce I'll Always Know What You Did Last Summer. So she cool. After meeting with dozens of directors, she hired Hong Kong-born Ronnie Yu. Yu wasn't super familiar with either series, but had just directed Bride of Chucky. He imagined Freddy vs. Jason as a pro wrestling-like event, with two larger-than-life figures going all out against each other.
I just want to make sure that there's enough blood there.
Dude succeeded in that regard, and others. Everything involving Freddy and Jason is great. They each get to shine in their own segments that feel tailored towards their types of terror. You have nightmarish scenes full of supernatural creepy stuff and scenes with senseless slaughter. Great! Even better is that the two of them square off multiple times, each bout better than the last. Yu grew up a comic book fan, which infiltrates the visual language of the film. He's an imaginative guy who could mentally storyboard his movies, and he has a lot of fun with colors. Aside from the annoying low frame rate slow motion, which I hate, I think he made a great looking film. But Yu wasn't as interested in working with his actors, a mix of Americans and Canadians since this was filmed in Vancouver. Their parts are poorly written, and their lack of direction is clear. I don't need all these meatbags to have rich, in-depth backstories, but at least make them somewhat likable. The folks running around here are just annoying. And don't say it doesn't matter because this is a slasher. We've seen plenty of likable characters in many Friday and Nightmare films. I think these jerks are more just a product of their time. The early 2000s had a nasty cynicism, and that nihilistic sarcasm bleeds through here. One last note, this movie's got flashing and strobing lights constantly, so maybe avoid this video if that's gonna affect you. Otherwise, let's see if the ultimate matchup can deliver some ultimate kills. The movie begins in a boiler room, cause Freddy's first build in this battle. He also gets first kill, this poor little girl he murders off screen.
Hey, what you doing with that picture, dude? This ain't the Nightmare remake yet, please stop.
He narrates his origin, like how he was killed by angry parents, though he does leave out that his powers came from a deal with dream demons.
I want it all!
Of course you do.
Then open up.
And you shall be forever!
Why wouldn't you mention that, Fred? Freddy's become powerless because kids have forgotten him, and to make them remember, he's gonna wake Jason up from hell. Best way to do that is with a whole lot of naked lady flash, provided here by Odessa Monroe. This very same year, she flashed her boobs on a motorcycle in Final Destination 2. Big year for her boobs. The maniacal mammary plan works, and Jason chases Heather into the woods before killing her with a machete stab that pins her to the tree. And Heather, you only count as one kill. Don't try that face morphing thing to inflate the stats. Yes, I'm counting Heather, even though she's a dream, just like Jason's mom is a dream. It's Pamela Voorhees, played by Paula Shaw. Betsy Palmer was offered the role, but said the dialogue sucked too much.
You promised me you'd kill all those people.
I'm an actress, for God's sake. Don't give me some dumb line like that.
Pamela directs Jason to get up and kill the kids of Elm Street. It'll really help a mother out. And by mother, I mean Freddy. Playing Freddy Krueger for his 8th feature film was Robert Englund, of course, the man synonymous with the character.
Notice who gets top billing.
And honestly, who wouldn't want Englund hanging around?
It's hard to get your motivation when he's being so nice all the time.
When it came to Jason, Kane Hodder seemed equally obvious to Friday fans and Sean S. Cunningham. But New Line kept Cunningham distant from the project. project, in part because of Jason X's failure. Hodder also suffered from association with his Friday films, which were usually regarded as pretty bad. Additionally, director Ronnie Yu said he wanted his Jason to have expressive eyes. Whereas Freddy was pure evil, the audience could get emotionally invested in Jason. So maybe Hodder's rage-filled murder machine that sometimes veered into humor didn't appeal to the director. I've heard people blame Yu, while he and others blame nameless studio execs.
The decision not to use Kane Hodder really had nothing to do with Ronnie.
But at the end of the day, I just feel bad that Hodder didn't get to be a part of this moment, especially after publicly advocating for the crossover for years.
I really wish I had been able to do it.
Instead of Hodder, Jason was played by 6'5" Canadian Ken Kurzinger, a stunt coordinator in his own right and occasionally an actor. We saw him as Pa Mutant in Wrong Turn 2. Kurzinger had played a New York cook manhandled by Jason in Takes Manhattan, where he also doubled for Hodder as Jason in Two Shots, getting hit by a car, and I think when they did the third rail bit in the subway tunnel. While I don't like this Jason sad droopy eye, I think Kurzinger does well reinventing the character. Gone is Hodder's heavy chest breathing and moving his head before his body. This Jason would be new, and to prove it, you gave him a new hockey mask. This one's browner, has cheek chevrons again, and is free of the Chris Higgins axe mark. Jason heads to Elm Street and the most famous house on the block, inside of which a bunch of teens are drinking, smoking, and lasciviating. Lori, who lives here, is trying to ignore this Blake bloke.
You know about feng shui?
She doesn't get help from her friend Kia, played by Kelly Rowland during Destiny's Child's 3-year hiatus. Blake was brought here by his bro Trey, the super douchey boyfriend to Lori's friend Gib.
Whoa, babe. Tell you about kissing me after you smoked, huh? Babe, make me ask you twice.
Babe. You know I don't like to be touched after, okay?
Babe, no touchy! Jason appears in the bedroom and kills Trey by stabbing him about 10 times with a machete. Impressively, Trey holds on to his beer the whole time. Good job, Trey. Spoke too soon.
Babe, you know I can only sleep when I'm shaped like a V.
The kids run screaming until they find the police. The older cops recognize the Freddy Krueger house and try to keep his name under wraps. They fail and Lori overhears them, then repeats the name to herself as she falls asleep at the police station.
Freddy.
That's basically an express pass to Nightmareville, USA. Population, a bunch of creepy kids on missing child posters, and one little girl who ain't got no eyes. Little eyeless Annie orders Lori to tell everyone about Fred Krueger, and to help her remember his name, here's a song! Yo, I know this is like the third reunion tour for the Jump Rope Girls, but I'm getting those tickets anyway. I'll take any performance I can get. Since Freddy's in Lori's head now, he wants to try killing again. He decides to go after Blake, who graduated from the Nicolas Cage Acting Academy.
My best friend was just killed, Dad!
Blake's Alex Jones looking dad there is played by Brent Chapman, who got killed by Michael Myers in the beginning of Halloween Resurrection. Blake drinks himself into a nap, and Freddy attacks him using Shadow Swipe. It's not very effective.
Okay. I'm alright.
Freddy tells the viewers that while he's still weak, Jason will have to keep killing. J-Man's already ahead of him, as Blakey wakes to find his dad decapitated on the porch. Blake grabs the head and hilariously tries to use it as a shield when Jason murders him. Now it's time for the nightmare-flavored characters of the film, as opposed to the more Friday-like group of teens all drinking and sexing. Lori's estranged ex-boyfriend Will and his buddy Mark are institutionalized at Westin, the psychiatric hospital from Nightmare 3 Dream Warriors. Will is played by Jason Ritter, whose dad John Ritter had just been directed by Ronnie Yu in Bride of Chucky. Mark is given an energetic performance by Brendan Fletcher, who was solid in the awful Leprechaun Origins. Will sees on the news that there was a murder at Lori's house, so Mark uses his butt cheeks to steal some keys and they escape. At school, Lori tells her friends about the burnt man from her dreams, and Mark shows up to keep yelling about Fred and turn Lori into a teary baby. He also scares, Evangeline Lilly? Girl, you've got an oceanic flight to make. With a good word of Fred's circulating around, Kia has a dream about him.
Got your nose!
I didn't realize this nose picking was half practical. They made a mold of Kelly Rowland's nose and designed nose innards behind it, then filmed the bit with the glove punching out and pulling off the nose in front of green screens. They also filmed real finger knives in Rowland's nose, with the glove worn by VFX supervisor Ariel Velasco Shaw. He and VFX producer Kevin Elam tried to incorporate practical effects whenever possible, even when it came to stuff like the face morphing tree victim in the beginning. Some sometimes they ran into issues, like with the blood drops in Lori's police station nightmare. They wanted to do those practically, but it didn't look right, not even with special prosthetics on a green screen. Doesn't look awful, considering how hard it is to fake fluids. Springwood's having a cornfield rager, where glow sticks and slow motion substitute for style. Lori, how hard are you rolling right now, girl? She's hit on by Linderman, the nerdy guy who likes her, and who's always trading insults with Kia.
We don't have time for data dork right now.
You tear me down to make yourself feel better because you really hate yourself, which is kind of pathetic when you actually stop and think about it, assuming, of course, you can think with all that makeup weighing down your head.
I don't like either of them, nor the goofy bully Shaq, who holds Linderman down and douses him with beer. In fact, I wouldn't mind these characters dying. Anyone know where Jason, I was just about to call you, man! Before he can get to business, a mournful Gib sneaks away to cry about her dead boyfriend. Oh, hey, Gib! There he is, as a decapitated head. Gib's played by Catherine Isabel, who we've seen in Bones in the Carrie miniseries. She's worked a ton in horror, most notably as Ginger in the Ginger Snap films. That horror pedigree doesn't stop her from falling asleep in cornfields, though. While nightmaring, she's treated to a parade of Freddy Krueger classics. When Freddy goes for the kill, Gib's chest explodes in his face. She's been impaled in real life along with a would-be rapist, courtesy of Jason, who chucks the guy into the air. See ya!
Aw, is there a killer who's whiny he didn't get that kill?
She's mine! Mine!
Yes, there is.
Listen, Fred, you're the one who ordered a murder machine. Don't complain when it shows up working perfectly. Jason keeps the kills coming with a bad-looking head twist on this random jock dude. Damn, that looks shitty. Shaq uses Everclear to light Jason on fire, which makes sense because it's high proof. But now Shaq's got a bigger problem, since Jason continues to chase him during a bitching fire stunt. After a short chase, Jason's like, boom! Throws his blade in the air for a stab. It goes through Shaq's body, goddamn! I swear, I'm just telling you the facts of how Jason killed Shaq. Now Jason's gonna fuck up everybody's night. I'll count 8 kills here, 2 more than I did before. I never noticed these 2 background bodies. They're not dressed like any of the other 6 kills, which are mostly pretty bad, by the way. You can see this guy's blood contraption underneath his shirt, and this dude goes down bleeding even though Jason clearly misses him. I've never been a fan of the rave massacre scene, but the more I learn about the fire stunt, the more I'm impressed. Ken Kurzinger wanted to do it, but since they didn't want to risk their Jason actor, stunt performer Glenn Ennis stepped in. Ennis wore a layer of Nomex, a high-temperature resistant material, which was then slathered in fire-resistant gel. He looks like a greasy baby there. Aw, oh, and they filled his gloves with it too? Gross. On top of the gel, an accelerant was sprayed to ignite quickly and keep the fire going. Ennis had to breathe through an apparatus in the hockey mask as he walked 75 feet fully engulfed in flames. The smoke blocked his sight, so he had to do it blind, directed by a radio in his ear. Watching what went into this stunt makes me more forgiving of these lame-ass kills. Who cares if a blood-spraying prosthetic is visible? They had a man on fire there! The important thing was making sure they put him out.
That was the last burn scene with Glenn Ennis, ladies and gentlemen.
Silly Willy shows up and helps the other characters get away. He drops them off, then tells Lori why he got locked up in the first place. One time, a few years ago, he watched through her window as Lori's dad killed her mom. Shitty dad, dude. Together, they go to Mark's since he's their Freddy expert. But that sleepy little guy has dozed off on his feet and now he's dreaming about his dead brother. Great casting of these two as siblings. Brother Bobby looks just like Mark, only with yellow eyes. So help me God, yellow eyes! I'll put Bobby on the count now since we see him in his disturbing death state, murdered by Fred Krueger, but deemed a suicide. Mark gets attacked in a nightmare-style scene that ends far too quickly. We all know Freddy does great work in the bathroom. Will and Lori get there just in time to watch Mark get murdered in his sleep. Krueger sends him out with a message and a branding that kinda looks like the Fight Club soap, IMO. There's a summit of awful characters in the basement of Stoner Freeberg, who should probably be out looking for his missing Silent Bob.
Then screw that clown. Now that big-ass motherfucker back at the cornfield. Alright, that's who we should be afraid of. Tell me who the fuck that was.
They're joined by Deputy Stubbs, a newbie to Springwood, who's been kept in the dark about Fred Krueger by his boss, Sheriff Williams. Williams is played by Gary Chalk, another beacon of light in the inky black turd of Leprechaun origins. Stubbs is played by Lachlan Monroe, now known for Riverdale, but to me, he'll always be the Ryan Phillippe knockoff in Scary Movie. Stubbs has learned about Jason Voorhees and tells the others his backstory. Big Brain Will puts the pieces together real fast.
I mean, what if Freddy brought Jason back because he was too weak to go after us on his own, so He used Jason.
Shit, dude, you nailed it. That is this movie's plot. This scene is all plot stuff with the clunkiest of dialogue.
Freddy died by fire, Jason by water. How can we use that?
This wasn't part of the original script written by Mark Swift and Damian Shannon, but that thing was 130 pages long and would have run an estimated 2.5 hours. To fix it, director Ronnie Yu brought in writer David S. Goyer, who had written Blade and who would go on to co-write The Dark Knight. He also wrote Demonic Toys. Don't ever forget that, Dave! Goyer condensed the script, giving the movie its enjoyable breakneck pace.
Making scenes that were three scenes before into one scene, and when you do that, that one scene becomes a lot more dramatic and a lot more interesting.
The only downside is exposition dump shortcuts, like this scene and when Freddy freaking talks to the audience.
Not strong enough yet. Well, I will be soon enough.
Test screenings, which we usually complain about, also helped streamline the film. They led to the removal of long scenes with forced emotional beats, and even got rid of the occasional cheesy line.
Freddy versus Jason. Place your bets.
Lori has a wee baby nightmare where her friends become mean and her dad makes out with her. But she's gonna have to wait to analyze this Elektra shit. Right now, she's gotta push rapey Fred away and bring his ear into the real world. Wait, the real world? Yes, that's right. And just like Nancy Thompson learned in the original Nightmare, this may be the key to defeating Freddy. The kids remember Hypnosil, the dream-suppressing drug that was introduced in Nightmare 3. So they sneak into Weston Hills to steal a supply and keep themselves safe in slumber. They won't have to worry about the security guard either. That guy gets crushed with a door by Jason following them inside. During their hospital heist, Freeburg stays behind to light one up. Must be some heavy shit, cause now this Freddy Pillar bug bro is here, breaking out the hookah like this were Wonderland. The Freddy Pillar almost got cut to save money, but I'm glad they kept it in. I also love seeing these hilarious pre-visualizations of the effect, and the practical maquette they used on set. After a buggy shotgun, Berg winds up with a slug down his throat. And you thought we were done with Jason Goes to Hell, didn't ya? Now Freeburg's possessed by Freddy, so he dumps all the Hypnosil down the drain. Linderman stumbles upon him just in time to give this hilarious reaction.
Dude, no! Dude!
Jason joins the party and secures a kill with a secondhand Voorhees special. He grabs onto Stubbs and electrocutes him by means of a machete and electrical shit. I love how this doesn't seem to bother Jason one bit. J-Man chases after the others, but Freaky Freeburg don't flee with them.
Let me handle this, bitch.
He's got two supersized vials of drugs and sticks them into Jason with vigor. Before the J-Man collapses completely, he slashes Freeburg in half. Oh man, that's how you treat a body you're borrowing, Fred? It's like returning your friend's car on empty. The passed out Jason winds up in a Dreamland boiler room where Freddy attacks him bathed in red light. At first it seems like Jason's got things under control, but this is Freddy's world, bitch. So
let's get ready to rumble!
Fred, don't scratch up the mask. Dude just got a new one. Come on. Freddy plays pinball with Jason's body, thrusting him back and forth with some booyaka booyakas. This is apparently when Freddy's stunt double was Rey Mysterio, but I can't find any details about it or clips of people talking about it. The nightmare ends with Freddy learning that Jason has a fear of water, a plot point so stupid Swift and Shannon vocally disown it.
I just want to put the record straight. We never said that Jason was afraid of water. We never wrote that. That was not in our script.
They had intended to suggest Jason might have a fear of drowning, but during the revision process, that got changed. It's absurd, given that we know Jason's an accomplished swimmer. He's got an underwater hang zone with naked chicks, dude. He swam from a sinking ship all the way to the New York docks. Speaking of which, are we sure this water isn't New York's toxic waste? Because it just turned Jason into a little naked boy. Come on, movie. Nobody wants to see this again. Freddy finger hacks Jason's brain, and I guess I'll count 8 brain bodies here. 2 in the foreground, 1 that Jason's dragging, a couple of heads in the background, and 3 bodies floating in a closet. No, not you, Heather. I already counted you. The inner workings of Jason's mind required a combination of practical and visual effects. Production designer John Willett built Jason's slanting house in the middle of Bunsen Lake in Vancouver, British Columbia. Willett also recreated the Freddy house on Elm Street using a lookalike they found. I'm surprised I didn't notice it wasn't the original. I love that house! The visual effects team added the atmospherics and comped in Jason's closet full of floaty, soggy bodies. As with their other effects, they tried to go as practical as possible, but they often ran into issues that forced them to use CG. Like in the pinball sequence, they originally filmed the stunt performer on wires, making impact at various points. They only wanted to animate him in between the hits. But then Ronnie Yu saw a version that was all CG.
And Ronnie saw it, he's like, oh, that, I like that. That's what I want. And it became like,
You want that?
The kids take Jason's passed out body and start driving from Springwood, Ohio to Crystal Lake, New Jersey, at minimum a 6-hour drive. Their plan is to get Jason on his home turf, where he's strongest, then pull Freddy into the real world and watch Jason beat his ass. Lori puts herself to sleep so she can abduct the Fredster from Dreamland. She finds herself at Camp Crystal Lake in the 1950s, where Jason's a boy getting teased by other campers, and Freddy is a counselor who's fucking a dead chick? What the fuck, Fred? Lori tries to help Jason, but Freddy holds him down, causing him to drown in real life. He wakes up, and in the commotion, the van crashes and sends him flying. See ya. Jason disappears from Dreamworld, which pisses off Fred and turns him all sorts of red. I absolutely love this flying Freddy shot, and I dig how nasty his makeup looks here. Really cranks up the guy's evilness. Freddy's demon look was designed by Bill Terrazakis, a Canadian makeup artist who worked on tons of horror movies, including Wrong Turn 2 and Final Destination 2. I was hoping to meet Terrazakis one day, but while writing this script, I learned that he passed away in June at only 55 years old. Really bummed out about that. Rest in peace, man. His work here is dope. He added a layer of musculature over Freddy's classic look, then gave him sharp teeth and scary contact lenses. Speaking of Freddy's classic look, it was applied by Pat Murray and Margaret Jaworski. The foam latex pieces were airbrushed ahead of time, then stuck on Robert Englund's face, which was covered in an adhesive.
It's evolved over the years. Now it's, they wouldn't have been able to do a single piece this large a couple of years ago.
It took 3 hours to put on and one to remove, but Englund says the latex was porous and could at least breathe a little. Lori's stuck in a nightmare back at her house on Elm Street, and in it, she sees what really happened to her mom. Her dad didn't kill her, it was Freddy freaking Krueger.
I've always had a thing for the whores that live in this house.
Don't you call Nancy Thompson a whore, you bastard! Lori trips over some buckling floorboards that would be awesome if not for the strobing lights and choppy slow-mo.
Welcome to my world, bitch.
Fix your world's frame rate, bitch. Lori's friends carry her the rest of the way to Camp Crystal Lake, where they're shortly joined by Jason. He Kool-Aid mans his way inside a cabin and accidentally starts a fire. That wakes up Lori and allows her to grab Freddy and bring him into the real world. Now it's time for round two of FVJ, a relatively short Inferno match that has some decent spots. I like when Jason runs Freddy through the windows. He looks like Cabal doing an X-ray. This bout ends with Jason flinging Freddy into the air and through a roof. Before Lori and Fred even joined the party, J-Man was already flinging folks around. That's how Linderman wound up impaled through his side, which is why he's now bleeding against a tree. I like that he and Kia were given a little arc together, even if it wasn't well executed. He tells her he'll be fine and that she should go help the others, but he was lying. He will not be fine. That dude deader than a lecherous camp counselor. Kia gets back to camp and talks mad shit to Fred Krueger with some dialogue Swift and Shannon stress were not written by them. She doesn't realize that she's backing up right into Jason Voorhees, who sends her flying to her death against a tree. Ugh, again with the choppy slow-mo. I wish someone had told Ronnie Yu, no, 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 no. We're back to Freddy versus Jason again, and this last bout has got some length to it. After a regular brawl, Freddy starts launching huge tanks at the J-Man. He's hit and flies backwards with a great wire stunt that lands him at a construction site, a vestige of earlier story drafts that involved a housing development subplot. Freddy impales Jason with a bunch of rebar and knocks him around silly with a swinging cement mixer. This entire final sequence was a heavy lift for stunt coordinators Monty Simons and Scott Attia. They had already dealt with the intense cornfield fire stunt and flinging Ken Kurzinger out of a van spinning around on a giant gimbal. Now they had to do a ton of wire stunts, requiring the expertise of veteran stunt rigger Kurt Bond, who passed away in 2017. Rest in peace. The stunt team was grateful for the stars they worked with. Kurzinger was, of course, a stunt coordinator himself, so professional he could finish a scene even with his foot accidentally stuck in a box. The 55-year-old Robert Englund wanted to do as much as he could, which is why that's him hanging upside down in the cement mixer and doing his own underwater shots. But for the high-flying wire stunts, Doug Chapman stepped in, meaning he's the guy who flew through the air at the awesome dock shot. Man, that looks like it'd be so much fun to do! F and J fight back and forth until a cart launches them to the final fighting stage, the Crystal Lake Docks. There, we get our biggest hits and most voluminous blood sprays. I appreciate that it's filmed in long shots instead of quick quick cuts. Don't give me that Kevin Dunn bullshit.
Just put the camera there and let them chop each other out.
Freddy cuts off Jason's fingers, leaving him with a handful of chodes. Then he takes Jason's machete and dual wields the two iconic weapons. Finally, he sticks his finger knives deep into Jason's eye holes and chest. Meanwhile, Lori and Dipper Pines have been dousing the dock in gasoline. She runs with a torch like an Uruk-hai at Helm's Deep and lights it all ablaze. That puts the fear of God into Freddy, because remember,
Freddy died by fire, Jason by water, how can we use that?
As the fire rages on, Jason rips off Freddy's arm. Fred sticks him deep with his own machete until an explosion goes off. It sends them flying in a stunt that earned Chapman and Ennis a nomination for a Taurus World Stunt Award. Wait, there's a stunt award show? With live performances sometimes? That's awesome! Lori and Will survive, but don't you sappy sops be hugging just yet, because walking towards them with a machete is Freddy freaking Krueger! He's one-armed and pissed! Jason interferes a final time before he must go, for his people need him. Lori finishes the job herself by using Fred Krueger's words against him.
Welcome to my world, bitch!
She takes that machete and decapitates Freddy, killing him enough for me to put him on the count. I mean, look at that body. Look at that head. I know he's gonna wink later, but the Fred is dead. Jason's not dead, though. He's just taking an underwater nap. Here's his machete for when he wakes up. Lori and Will hobble away, the movie ready to end. At first, they weren't sure how to end it, though. Originally, it ended in hell, complete with an appearance from Satan. At one point, Pinhead showed up, but New Line doesn't even own that guy. One ending, written by David Goyer, was filmed with a PG-13 sex scene and Will possessed by Freddy Krueger. They settled on a simple shot of Jason rising out of the lake carrying Freddy's head. Since the filmmakers were back in Los Angeles at this point, they used Doug Tate to play the J-Man, as Kurzinger was in Canada. Freddy, of course, was still played by Robert Englund. Look at him in that green screen shirt. Fred gets the last laugh, literally, after winking to the audience on their way out. With twice as many killers, did we have twice as many kills as usual? Let's find out.
Get to the numbers, huh? I hope it's a high score. You're next, bitch.
Well, well!
Whoo! I counted 35 kills in Freddy vs. Jason this time around. 7 of them female, 21 of them male, and 7 of them unknown brain bodies floating around. Should those have even gone on the count? No, really, I'm asking, should I have done that? With a runtime of 97 minutes, that left us with a kill on average every 2.78 minutes. I'll give the golden chainsaw for coolest kill to Trey. Despite the stupid slow-mo, the machete stabs are brutal. And how can I not love Jason folding a guy into an acute angle? Dull machete for Lamas kill will go to the jock at the rave. I really don't like that effect. You can see it shift around as his body falls. And that's it. Freddy vs. Jason came out in 2003 and was a box office smash as predicted. It grossed more than any film in either franchise before it. Not everybody liked it, including Nightmare's creator Wes Craven, who wasn't involved with the property anymore at this point.
I found it really just kind of brutal without being very imaginative.
There was idle talk of a sequel, including one with Ash Campbell that eventually found life in comic book form, but another film never happened, and now Englund says he's done playing Freddy. I've got one more recount for you, the Friday the 13th reboot next week, but until then, I'm James A. Janisse. This has been the Kill Count.
Next Kill Count. Hey, you want another Kill Count?
Yes.
Okay, but you're gonna have to be quiet about it. We're back in the world of A Quiet Place, which means if you make a sound, you're gonna be
alien food!
Ah, shit, I'm sorry. Okay, back to quiet. Gotta be quiet for A Quiet Place Part 2, a sequel to the movie that made you never want to order nachos again. All our faves are back, even John Krasinski. And that guy died in the first one. Good thing his replacement is Cillian Murphy.
Oh, dude, I loved you in Red Eye. Ah, shit. Oh, shit. I'm so sorry.
Okay, we should probably wrap this up.
Thank you.
In A Quiet Place Part 2, the aliens are bountiful, and the character logic isn't. Seriously, Marcus, why wouldn't you stay below ground?
Why would you go above ground, dude? God, shit, whatever, man, fuck it. Watch A Quiet Place Part 2 this weekend and try not to get killed so you can tune in for the Kill Count on Sunday, only on Dead Meat.
Fuck off, alien!
The Quiet Place Part 2 can currently be watched on the pictured streaming platforms. Demi always recommends you watch the movie for yourself before its kill count. It's the only way to have your own properly informed opinion. Kill counts are never meant to replace the experience of watching a film.
Hey, everybody! Thanks for watching this kill count. The third one of Freddy vs. Jason, but I added a lot more this time. Chelsea is Freddy.
I'm Freddy!
And Zoran is Jason.
I'm Roy Burns.
You're gonna be seeing a lot more of this guy in January when he's covering the Tremors series on the kill count while we go off and get married.
We're getting married!
So, be good people!
People, bitch!